So the moment that Abdullah saw the face of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like, this guy isn't, you can tell if this guy is a crooked politician or he's someone who's trying to use religion. He saw him sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he realized, you know what, this guy is something else. Which, by the way, whenever I read this hadith, I feel hopeful that all of us in this room, we believed in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Okay. I will start with a story that maybe understanding the story can tell you why someone like me can start the panel where we have Imam Dawood and Imam Mustafa Turk on the panel. This story explains to us actually a very important concept in Islam, is that students and students of students are allowed and are empowered to even speak and lecture in front of, even if we had other more knowledgeable and more credible people in the audience. It's not because I'm special or they are special. It's because this is how our deen is built. This is by design. It doesn't have to do with the people. It's actually what Islam is all about. And this story would show us actually an incident that happened after the seerah. So I have tons of stories from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but let me tell you the product of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where a random man from the Muslim army was appointed to go and speak to Rustum, the leader of the Persian army. So Arabs were known to be Bedouins, losers, just wandering around, going from place to place. And the Persians and the Romans know Arabs as beggars and know them as just a bunch of robbers and people who can do poetry all day and drink all night. This was the image of Arabs back then. And all of a sudden, the Persians hear about these Arabs coming together with an army under a guy named Mohammed. And of course, he was passed away. But yeah, they hear about these changes, but they did not really understand what was happening. So Rustum took his army and camped in a place near Al-Qadisiyah, where the famous battle between the Muslim army and the Persian army took place. Before the battle, usually there's some negotiations, there's some understanding, they're trying to talk. And Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, the leader of the Muslim army, appointed one random man to just speak to the Persians. It was not the outspoken person, it was not a poet, it was not a political analyst from the Muslims, it was not a PhD from Harvard, or the like, who was given the opportunity to speak to Rustum. Just, hey, Rab'i bin Amir, you go talk to him. So if Sa'd appointed Rab'i to speak, although he was not the most knowledgeable or the most eloquent, maybe Mohannad can speak when other people are present. Anyway, back to Al-Qadisiyah, where Rab'i, so Rustum tried to impress the representative of the Muslims. He tried to show him his place. His image of these Arabs or Muslims is that as people who are losers in life, so he had a huge tent built at the place of the battle. So imagine, instead of preparing for the arms and the soldiers, they were trying to impress the Arabs. So they had all kinds of fine carpets with pillows, with huge tent, with very amazing ornaments. And they were like, this guy, when he enters our tent, he will be like, oh my God, he will be scared. They wanted to impress him. And Rab'i understood this. So when he came on his mule, and they wanted him to park his mule outside. He said, no, I'm entering your tent with my mule. I was like, whoa, you Muslims, I thought you're supposed to take your shoes off when you enter a place. No, that's not a position where you should show humility and being humble. You should show your strength. And he said, I did not come here by myself. You guys invited me. So either you talk to me like who I am, or I'll go back. So Rab'i entered the tent, and with all of these fine carpets, he had his spear, and he started actually poking the spears with poking the carpets to make sure that he's telling them, hey, I'm not impressed. And when he went out of his mule, he tied it with the chair that Rustum was sitting on. This is not something, you're not going to impress me. So Rustum said, hey, what brought you here? Why are you here? Why are you coming to us? Can't we just give you some money and go? And Rab'i said
an amazing statement that I was, when I read the statement, wallahi, wallahi, there's so many books written on the statement of Rabi. There's so many literature. I'm like, did he prepare it? You know these quotes that you prepare, that you try to put them within 140 characters on Twitter, or try to fit them within your post on Facebook so that it looks like fancy? Rabi said, Allahu ta'athana. Allah sent us. It's not Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas. It's not Umar bin Khattab. Not even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are sent by Allah, by God. لِنُخْرِجَ مَنْ شَاءَ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ الْعِبَادِ إِلَىٰ عِبَادَةِ رَبِّ الْعِبَادِ. Allah sent us to take away, to take out, to save whoever wants to be saved from worshipping other creations and slaves to worshipping Allah, the Lord of all creations and slaves. Whoa, 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 Rab'i. Big words. Yes, of course it's big words. Because he was taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By the way, Rab'i again is not the official representative of the Sahaba. Rab'i is somebody that had it not been for him to be selected in this occasion, we wouldn't have heard about Rab'i at all. He was a nobody, quote unquote, who became somebody. And this shows us the tarbiyah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not that focusing on the few, no. Pick any one of the Sahaba, he would give you the same thing. And actually, if we had more time, I would have gone through other two representatives from the Muslim army in Al-Qadisiyah who went to Rustum, and Rustum wanted to examine how they talk. And everyone, mashallah, gave an amazing answer after an amazing answer. We used to be, when I used to be part of a Saturday school-like environment in Lebanon, we used to have those amazing students who memorize the whole Quran, and they have a nice voice. And we always have them recite Quran in the beginning. And the same student, I remember at one point, we had one student who was very special, mashallah. So every masjid, every Saturday school, every program, they would invite him to recite. People think this is our guy. People think this is our guy, just because we didn't have nobody other than him. But if you pick any sahabi from the sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would give almost the same answer. So what was the answer of Rabi'i? Allahu ta'athana, Allah has sent us to take away those from worshipping creations to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ ضِيقِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَىٰ سَاعَةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. And from the constriction of the worldly materialistic life to the vastness of the dunya and the akhirah. He did not say dunya versus akhirah, because we are also to love dunya. We want the dunya, but our eyes are on the akhirah. وَمِنْ جَوْرِ الْأَدْيَانِ إِلَىٰ عَدْلِ الْإِسْلَامِ. And from all the oppression that happened under the name of religions to the justice in Islam. So if you think about Rabi'i having this clarity, this awesome statement that really has shaken Rustum a lot. And by the way, Rustum did not want to fight the Muslims. After he has seen three representatives, he actually wanted to break a deal with the Muslims. But his cronies and people around him and ministers said, you know what? No, no. We need to fight. And subhanAllah, that was the biggest defeat for the Persian Empire under the hands of the likes of Rabi'i bin Amir, who understood we're not there to fight. Muslims are not colonizing other parts of the land. So what made all of this? How were Muslims able to establish this? How the Prophet ﷺ raised his Sahaba to be like Rabi'i? I will go over some seerah examples. And all of these, this is my commercial break, by the way. This is kind of part of my upcoming book, inshallah ta'ala, that I'm putting together, the 40 hadith on activism, which is, inshallah ta'ala, trying to collect the 40 ahadith, sayings and teachings and incidents from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that try to have a curriculum to activists, basically, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah, with the help of other curriculums and books that our Imam has written, inshallah ta'ala, we can enrich our books and our literature with such incidents. So starting with the first incident, in early Mecca, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving da'wah to the elite and the rich and those powerful people in Quraysh. And they started negotiating with him. So us, the chieftains, us, the rich people, are going to sit next to Bilal and Suhaib and Khabbab, an ex-slave, someone who's an immigrant who just came to Mecca and got a citizenship or even a green card. And what about Ammar bin Yasir? No way. So some of them had some inclination to listen to the Quran, but they said, by the way, we want our private class, private halaqah. We want something only for the rich, for the elite, for Banu Hashim, for Banu Abdu Manaf, but we cannot sit on the same table with these people. And the Prophet ﷺ at that time was so desperate for them to speak, to listen to the Quran. He was like, maybe, why not? Sometimes we talk about compromise, talk about trying to have a win-win situation, meet me halfway, all that stuff. So the Prophet ﷺ probably, and again, this shows us that he doesn't own this religion. Even if he had his own personal ijtihad or analysis, let's talk to the smart people among the Sahaba, what should we do? Maybe he had some inclination. And this shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one protecting this deen, not even the Prophet ﷺ, where Allah revealed ayat from Surah Al-An'am. He told him, وَلَا تَطْرُدِ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِدُونَ وَجْهًا. Do not kick them away from your gathering, from your classes, from your environment, because these are the ones who are more important in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more than these chieftains who claim to be humble and that stuff. We all know the other story of عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى. Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum, he's a blind man, but he's a believer. And he was coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to ask him for new information about Islam. And he was trying his best to give the da'wah to the Quraysh. So technically, there's nothing wrong with what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Okay, it's not a priority. By the way, according to the fiqh, if an imam is giving a khutbah jum'ah, and somebody came to ask about Islam, and he's not a Muslim or she's not a Muslima, according to some madhahib, you would stop the khutbah, go answer his question, and then continue the khutbah. Because this person is not a Muslim yet, maybe he or she may not live till after Salat. So technically you can give a priority to somebody who is asking about Islam and let the other believers wait, because guess what? In this half hour, they may not lose their religion. It's not a big deal. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pointing out is that, Ya Muhammad, this guy, Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, is more beloved to Allah than these people who are arrogant and they are not asking, they don't really want to be guided. So subhanAllah, it shows us how dear were these minorities to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to Islam, so much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not want him to compromise anything. No, you either, if they come to the religion, they either accept it as it is, or we are not going to bend to accommodate their whims. An interesting story happened in Medina. So in Medina, there were 6 years, or almost 6 years of war between Mecca and Medina, between the Muslims and the Quraysh. And then there was a truce. There was a ceasefire, Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. At that point, Abu Sufyan visited Medina. He is a leader among the Quraysh community, visiting Medina, walking in times of peace. So Bilal, Suhaib, Ammar saw him. And of course, they are abiding by the laws of the truce. They are not offending him. But they could not but say some strong words against him. They said, Wallahi ma nalat suyufullahi min aduwillahi naylaha. The sword of Allah did not have the chance to reach the neck of the enemy of Allah. Whoa, 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 that's direct threat, right? So they were threatening Abu Sufyan in the times of peace, supposedly. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu saw the situation. And he saw these, Sahaba who were, by the way, they are free now. They're not slaves anymore. They are citizens in Medina. They are honored citizens. But still, they always remember the times where they were oppressed. And they could not but say these few words. And Abu Bakr tried to contain the situation. And he told them, أَتَقُلُونَ هَذَا لِسَيِّدِ قُرَيْشِ. Why would you say this to the chieftain of Quraysh, to the leader of Quraysh? And he did not rebuke them. He just told them, hey guys, slow it down. Keep it easy. Keep it down. And they went to the Prophet ﷺ. So now you have, technically, Bilal, Ammar, Suhaib, who said these few words against Abu Sufyan. Maybe a war can happen because of this. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who tried to calm them down. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the mercy to mankind sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the one who knows that you have to be politically correct. And if I had some time, maybe I would talk about some ahadith about being politically correct and the PR image of the Muslims. But at some times, the honor and dignity of your Muslim brothers and sisters, especially those who always consider themselves as oppressed and minorities, sometimes you have to really give the extra attention to them. It's not always that we want to look nice and and modern and that stuff. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Ya Abu Bakr, لعلك أغضبتهم. Ya Abu Bakr, maybe the way you rebuked them and you told them this way, maybe you made them angry. وإن أغضبتهم فلقد أغضبت ربك. If you make them angry, then Allah will be angry from you. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq went to them and said, Hey, do you guys forgive me? That was the Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And of course they said, يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكَ يَا أَخِي. May Allah forgive you. But it shows us that subhanAllah, sometimes when we are living in contentious situations, sometimes we might get more harsh, more stringent on our own brothers and sisters just to look good. And we have to understand there are some priorities, subhanAllah. So now let's give the other. So that was in Mecca, and there's one incident in Medina. Moving on to the first time, the first khutbah of the Prophet ﷺ that he gave in Medina. And this khutbah was given to us, was narrated to us by a Jewish person, Abdullah ibn Salam. This guy was a rabbi, and he represented the Jewish community in Medina, which were almost, I would say, a half of the population in Medina. So they're a big number. And these Jewish people, they had in their books the news about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam being the final prophet. They were hoping he would be from them. It didn't happen, of course. And he was among the people to go and listen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his first khutbah, where he said, actually, when I saw him, the moment I saw Muhammad, I realized his face is not the face of a liar, sallallahu alaihi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the moment that Abdullah saw the face of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like, this guy isn't, you can tell if this guy is a crooked politician or he's someone who's trying to use religion. He saw him sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he realized, you know what, this guy is something else. Which, by the way, whenever I read this hadith, I feel hopeful that all of us in this room, we believed in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We follow his sunnah, we read his seerah, we try to learn his ahadith, we try to memorize the Quran, and we have never seen him. And we didn't have the chance to hear a hadith from his beloved mouth sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like right straight from the source. This guy, have the battle to become a Muslim was ended after he saw the face of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now what did he say? He said the khutbah was very short. The khutbah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave was super short. أيها الناس أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا الأرحام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخل الجنة بسلام. الله أكبر. So the Muslims were almost one third of the communities in Medina. You had Arab pagans, you had the Jews. It was a kind of a melting pot of different nations, different religions, different communities. So it was not an easy situation. Some of them converted to Islam. Most Arabs did not convert to Islam at that point. The Arabs, they had two tribes, Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, and both of them, they had civil wars between them. So it was not, sometimes we think that Prophet came to Medina sallallahu alaihi wasallam and boom, everything is right, everything. You have like Muslim flags on every, I don't know if there's a Muslim flag by the way. But anyway, you will see like peace everywhere. It was not an easy situation, but it was the proactive strategy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who gave specific instructions. He gave them, he could have given them a lot of arkan, but he focused on few action items. Afshu salam, spread the peace. Afshu salam, when a Muslim converts or reverts to Islam in a family or a neighborhood, people should feel peace. People should feel, this is a person I can talk to. This is a person I can open up to. أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام, and feed the people. Feed the people whether they are poor or not. Because when you break bread with somebody, you technically win their hearts. So the strategy of the Prophet ﷺ was not only about being a social justice warrior who's always there for trouble. Sometimes you just want to win hearts. You want to really break that barrier between you and the other person. And there's no better way than food, subhanAllah. And that's why, alhamdulillah, our Islamic events, we always have the most amazing food. We have good baklava. We have good sweets. It's simply because the best way to break bread with somebody and to win their heart. أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا الأرحام, and connect with your family members. Even if they are not disbelievers. Even if they are family members who might be engaged in civil war, and there's rivalries, and there's revenge, and there's all kinds of contentions between you, وَصِلُوا الْأَرْحَامِ. So if you happen to start your way to religiosity, and you are the only religious person in your family, wallahi, the best da'wah you can give to your family members is to show them how Islam changed you. Is to show them how Islam made you a better person. Is to show them that, hey, you know what? I'm going to throw a party, halal party, of course, every other week. I'm going to invite you over. You guys can come to my house. I can babysit your kids and maybe teach them something. And they, you know. So you should be the source of hope and peace for all of those around you. Wasilul arham. Now, the Prophet ﷺ talking about, and maybe talking about outer activities. Afshu salam, this is kind of a community service. وَأَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامُ, feeding the people. وَصِلُوا الْأَرْحَامُ, that's social connections. But then he focused on a very important aspect in the hadith. وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ, and pray in the night when everyone is sleeping. He was focusing, and this will be the segue to Imam Dawood's part, inshallah ta'ala, that activism is not about what the face that you show to the outer world. How fancy are your tweets? Or how amazing are your lectures? Or how deep is your coat that you steal maybe from someone else and you just put them. It's about your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ. We have to remember that when we are trying to correct the ills and the injustices in the community outside, we should make sure that our relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in place. وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ. The more activism you do outside, the more you should have your own wird of the Qur'an. The more that you should have your own personal, you know, development. One of our teachers used to tell us that, you know, the 80-20 rule, they talk a lot about this in time management and stuff. He was talking particularly to public speakers. Those brothers or sisters who teach, who can teach at an Arabic school or Islamic school or give khutbah or stuff. If you only prepare what you teach the other people, if you can only research and read some stuff so that you post it on social media and you look smart and religious, mashallah, then there's a problem. At least what you should learn and grasp for yourself should be the 80%, and the 20% is what you give others. Whereas if I only read some information so that I go and present it, then one of my other friends, he has a very nice analogy. He's like, if you eat food quickly and then you start working out, you're gonna vomit. You're going to throw up, right? So if I only read some information so that I share it and look smart, then guess what? Technically, my body did not benefit from it. My body, I'm not actually, I'm eating junk food and I'm going to throw it. I'm going to vomit. So if our activism becomes only to impress others and we are not internalizing what we're learning, then guess what? You're not actually eating. You are getting the right nutrition of hadith and Quran and knowledge and science, but your body is not benefiting from it. It's only to the outside. One of my teachers has a very profound hadith where he says, actually he would say the dua, and it's a dua from him basically. Ya Allah, do not make me a bridge that others can cross and go to Jannah, but this bridge will fall into hell. Because Prophet ﷺ gave us actually, and wallahi, I feel it many times. رُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَفْقَهُ مِنْهِ. Sometimes a carrier of knowledge will carry it to somebody who is more deserving of this knowledge than him or her. So, and again, I'm looking at some people in the eyes, people who are, I know, mashallah, they attend classes and they're everywhere and in a lot of events, and they are, mashallah, involved. This is for us. This is for you guys. That's for me. To make sure that I have my own version of ibadah. وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ. So we talked about the Prophet ﷺ not compromising, not caring about being politically correct. Say it as it is. If Bilal and Khabbab and Suhaib are offending Abu Sufyan, let him deal with it. It's fine. Ya Abu Bakr, make sure that you don't offend them. But that's not the only version of the seerah. And that's why it's very important that you understand the seerah in 3D. Some people like to see only one dimension only. That's it. Or two dimensions. And you always lose some information. That's why these new phones, you have like four cameras, I think, or fancy software that will tell you the depth, that will give you more information of what's happening around you. So here's one of my favorite ahadith. And the beautiful part of this hadith is that it was said later on in Medina after the conquest of Mecca. So now Islam is a superpower. Now Muslim army has 10,000 strong soldiers who conquered Mecca, no fighting whatsoever. Mecca surrendered. They were able to break all the idols. And alhamdulillah, everything is in its place. وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. At that point, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks to Aisha. Ya Aisha, I wish I can do something. Ya Rasulullah, now you are the man of the hour. Now if they had pictures, your picture will be everywhere. You will be that. Khalas, now the whole of Mecca surrendered to the Muslims and you can do whatever you want. Said, Ya Aisha, I wish, when he looked at the Kaaba had the way it's built at that point, it was not a completely built Kaaba, because we all know that the Kaaba at the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Ibrahim built it according to certain foundation. But then there were many incidents where the Kaaba was destroyed. The last of them was built by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam before he became a prophet. How old was he when he rebuilt the Kaaba? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam took part of rebuilding the Kaaba before he became a prophet, and he was 35 exactly. So I'm just making sure you guys are awake. Okay. So he was 35. He helped rebuild the Kaaba with the other Meccans, with the other people from Quraysh. So Quraysh at that point did not finish building the Kaaba and did not finish the construction, because they had this weird rule, which was correct, of course. We should not build the Kaaba from our haram money. We earn haram money, it's fine, we can eat it. We can, it's like the bars in Dearborn that have halal meat in them. So that's kind of, this is the situation. Okay, I'm from Dearborn, so Dearbornites, don't get offended. So the Quraysh understood that we should only build the Kaaba from our halal money. So if there's any money that was earned through riba, through interest, or usury, or through stealing, no, keep it aside, we'll do something else with it. Maybe we'll engage other wars, we'll fund other weapons, we'll fund other corrupt regimes, it's fine, but don't use it in building the Kaaba. I'm not giving any political, you guys, that's your own imagination, by the way. Okay, so the Quraysh could not completely build the Kaaba, and they knew that this was not enough. So the Prophet ﷺ realized that now it's probably a good time to rebuild the Kaaba according to the foundations, according to the area, according to the structure that Ibrahim ﷺ built. It was the right time. He just destroyed their idols. So maybe I can finish my thing and rebuild the Kaaba. But he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I wish, لَوْلَا أَنَّ قَوْمُكِ حَدِيثِي عَهْدٍ بِكُفْرٍ. Your community, the Meccans, they were kuffar just yesterday. And I really did not want to cause more turmoil, more rumors, more trouble. Had it not been that they just recently converted to Islam, I would have destroyed the whole Kaaba and built it again according to the foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this tells us that as a believer, as an activist, as a leader, as someone who's carrying Islam to Muslims and non-Muslims, those who may not understand what we are doing, sometimes you have to be smart about the way you approach things and choose your battles. لَوْلَا أَنَّ قَوْمِكَ حَدِيثِ عَدٍ بِإِسْلَامِ. Usually, most of the times where the Prophet ﷺ was not compromising, but just being lenient and politically correct, we interpret this as he was weak. They were a minority. They were just struggling. They were barely surviving in Mecca. But at this hadith in particular, he had the ultimate power, political power, military power, financial power to do whatever he wants, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have to understand there are some certain situations and limits. Not everything that can be said is to be said. Right? وَلَوْلَا أَنَّ قَوْمِكَ حَدِيثِ عَهْدٍ بِكُفْرٍ. So subhanAllah, another hadith which I will comment on very, 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 very quickly. Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul, the leader of the hypocrites in Medina. This guy was a troublemaker from day one. This guy accepted Islam only to because it was the political thing to do, it was the correct thing to do, is to become a Muslim. This guy was about to become the political leader of Medina, had the Muslims did not arrive to Medina, and the Prophet ﷺ technically took the power from him and took the glamour from him. And the guy was a big, big, big hater to Islam and the Muslims. There are surah in the Quran that were revealed about the munafiqeen, Surah At-Tawbah and Surah Al-Munafiqun. So this guy was known to be a munafiq. And one time he actually verbally abused and offended the Prophet ﷺ. He said, لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلُ. the most honorable among the Medina will actually kick the one who is humiliated. He offended the Prophet ﷺ, and his own son actually took the sword and was about to cut his head, his own son. And the Prophet ﷺ said, calm down. I don't want people to say that Muhammad kills his companions. Allahu Akbar. Again, that was in Medina, towards the second half of the Medina phase. So Muslims were strong, they had the army, they had the power. They don't have to worry much about what people say about them. But the Prophet ﷺ said, دَعْهُ حَتَّى لَا يَتَحَدَّثَ النَّاسِ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَقْتُلُ أَصْحَابَهُ صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Who knew how sometimes you have to understand that your actions have implications. It's not that I don't care about what the kuffar say and I'm going to say it as it is. No, there's a time and place for everything. And the more you read the seerah, you read it sometime, one time to get the events, and then you read again to understand the context of the events, and you put the seerah in the Quran and the wisdom and the opinions of the scholars, and you start seeing things in 3D and 4D. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us representation of the Muslim wisdom and the prophetic wisdom. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our Muslim community members here in Michigan, every single person, like Rabi'i bin Amir. You don't have to be the one who's more knowledgeable or more outspoken, because everyone here has something to offer to this ummah and to this community. Everyone here has something awesome to say, and inshallah ta'ala, your actions, your words, your tweets, your advice that you give to others, whether in public or in private, will be recorded in the books of the angels, and inshallah ta'ala, you will be remembered in the heavens as Rabi'i bin Amir is being remembered to our day. Barakallahu feekum, jazakum Allah khair, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.